to dop or not to dop? Unfortunately, for many athletes, this is not really a question. In this video, I will explain that the decision to dope is actually the optimal decision, at least in the short term.
One big lie.
I made such a huge mistake.
Hello and thank you for being with me. I'm Alex Krumer and I'm an economist who likes to use sports data to study things beyond sports. As usual, I will try to make it straight and to the point. Today, we will talk about game theory and its application in sport. Game theory is a field that deals with strategic interactions between individuals in situations that involve cooperation or conflict. In other words, what would be my best strategy given the strategy of the other individual? Then the problem is...
And knowing that we know his methods, he will alter them. But knowing that he knows that we know that he knows, he might choose to return to his usual pattern.
Sounds complicated, right? So game theory is exactly about it. It is also important to note that the main assumption about the individuals is that they are rational. In other words, they want to maximize their subjective expected utilities. Without going into the complicated analysis of what rationality is, here is the example. In Tokyo 2020 Olympics, the two best high jumpers finished the competition with exactly the same result. So who gets the gold medal? There were two options on the table.
We can continue with the jump off.
Can we have two gold?
It's possible.
This means that either each jumper has a probability of 50% to win a gold medal, or each of them gets this gold medal with certainty. What would they choose?
It depends if you decide.
History,
if you both decide on
the championships.
That was easy, right? Now let's talk about less pleasant decisions that often occur in sports. The decision to use doping, which not only provides an unfair advantage, but may also have serious health consequences. To better understand the decision to use doping, we have to understand the way athletes think about their future. For example, one study showed that professional athletes have biased time preferences. The win-at-all-cost orientation causes athletes to sacrifice their future in order to win in present. Given such a strong focus on here and now, game theory can easily predict that the usage of doping is actually an optimal choice. This is because a decision to dope is not only a decision that belongs to a single athlete. It is rather a coordination problem among all the athletes. I will try to explain. But first, let's consider a situation where two criminal suspects are taken into custody and separated such that they cannot communicate. The district attorney tells them that he has not enough evidence to convict them in a trial. But several outcomes are possible. If one confesses and the other does not, the confessor will be released and the other will be sentenced for a long time. If neither confesses, the attorney will have them both taken in on a minor charge. If both confess, they will both be prosecuted, but the attorney will recommend leniency. In fact, this is one of the famous examples in game theory. It is called a prisoner's dilemma. So what should the prisoners do? Well, in general, among the possibilities available to the prisoners, they should choose the one that, whatever the other individual does, gives them the best deal than they would have gained by any other choice. This means that their optimal option is to confess. However, this is not the best outcome for each of them. They could have been better off by choosing another strategy. This means that if coordination and joint action were possible, they could agree upon not confessing strategy and reach a better outcome. However, there is always a temptation to break the agreement and achieve an even better option. Thus, the joint not confessing option is an unstable solution.
Hey, I want to confess.
I want to confess.
In the same spirit, we can look at the choice to use doping in professional sport. Let us consider the following possible options. If both athletes dope, they are both have a 50% probability to win. The same if they both do not dope, which is of course better because they don't harm their health in the long term. However, if one of them dopes and the other sticks to the fair play, the cheater has a larger probability of winning. Thus, given that doping increases the chance of winning, the best choice is to dope. This is because even if the athletes agree not to dope, there is always a temptation to dope since it gives an advantage. This means that in order to fight doping, we need to use rational tools so that the athletes would better off not to dope. The obvious one is to increase the risk of being caught. This is done by the increased number of tests of the current and previous tournament. Second is to increase the costs associated with being caught.
I'm out of good.
In all seven of your Tour de France victories, did you ever take banned substances or blood dope?
Yes.
This can be done by monetary fines, cancellation of commercial contracts, and disqualification.
They are my mistake. And I am sitting here today to acknowledge that and to say I'm sorry for that.
One study even offered to introduce conditional pension funds from which the athletes can draw only after the end of their careers and only if they have never been caught doping. There are also possibilities of changing the prize structure. For example, a skewed prize structure where only a small fraction of athletes can win a prize may lead to more doping than a competition with many prizes. So let's hope for a clean sport. The athletes should understand that there is life also after sport. It can be much healthier and happier without doping. Choose this strategy. It is really the optimal one. I hope you like this video. All the references to the relevant studies in the video appear in the description. If you want to see more videos like this, please subscribe to my channel. Likes and comments are there, and they are more than welcome. I hope to see you soon.